call this meeting of the Pownal Planning Commission to order at 7:02 PM. The first order of business is to consider the agenda for the regular meeting of Tuesday, May 17, which is before you in your folder. After somebody takes a look at it, I'd like a motion to...
Hello?
And Mr. Winchester arrives at 7:03. You're here.
He made it!
Sometimes.
We just started.
We just started. Motion to adopt the agenda for May 17?
I did.
Bonnie made the motion, second.
Motion and a second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, going to that agenda then, we have approval of the May 17, 2016. I'm sorry, the April 19, 2016 minutes of a special meeting. Those appear in your yellow folder. Let's take a look at those. Good evening.
Good evening.
And good evening.
Jen.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to call for a motion to approve the minutes of the special meeting held on Tuesday, April 19, 2016. Unless there are corrections, so moved by Mr. Bisson. Is there a second?
Second.
By Mr. Winchester. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Next item on the agenda is the approval of the work session minutes for May 3rd, 2016. Also in your yellow folder. Okay, did I hear you make a motion to approve those minutes? Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? You have mail? Because
yes.
If you have a lot, or even if
we
you have,
do a, have a lot. It,
okay, then I'm going to take public comment out of order.
Okay.
Somebody's waiting here. I had a call over the weekend from Robin Baker, who was here tonight. She has presented some remarks in a printed email that she's given us. For those of you who have not had a chance to read it, please take a second to do so. Okay, Ms. Baker, you have our undivided attention.
It took great effort not to incorporate all of that other laundry list in there.
But I was trying to get your attention, and I didn't want to belabor the point.
And your name is?
Robin Baker. My husband
at?
Gary is with me.
Hi, Gary.
Hey.
And you live at?
1268 Maple Grove Road.
Okay. And why don't you tell us why you wanted to meet with us?
This situation has been ongoing for a number of years. I first called the zoning administrator on Easter Sunday, perhaps the day before. I'm not 100% you know, my recollection.
Had you called them prior to that?
No.
Okay.
I had not. And, you know, he kind of, it was Easter, and I understand his reluctance to get involved in a neighbor dispute, but he kind of shrugged me off as he can do what he wants. It's his property. And I said, you know, the noise is just unacceptable. It was a gorgeous weekend. We couldn't go outside. At the same time that the chainsaw and the excavator were going, there was a very large bonfire going that set off my smoke alarms in my kitchen on Saturday. We tried to go sit in the yard, and ash was falling. We had cold drinks. Ash was falling in the drinks. My eyes swelled up and shut. The laundry on the line all had to get rewashed. So I called the fire warden, who shut the fire down instantly. Craig Odell is an asset to this town. As a result, my neighbor became very irate and sent three children on four-wheelers and dirt bikes riding in a circle around the perimeter of my property. Easter Sunday, while he ran back and forth up the little dirt road that he's built on my property line with his excavator. This is not a new piece of equipment. The last thing I did today was print off the decibel readings for an excavator at the 50-foot mark, which greatly exceed the noise ordinance. And he's not...
The daytime decibel limits for the noise ordinance.
70. Excavator at 50 feet.
But this is, excuse me, this is not your observation with the decibel meter. This is what is printed somewhere.
My decibel meter has exceeded 110. The difficulty with the decibel meter is I can tell you that, but how do I show you unless we're standing there listening to it happen? Mm-hmm. And that's why I went to the internet today to find out. The excavator at 50 feet generates 85 decibels. This is not a new piece of machinery. It's old, the bucket is loose, and it shakes and echoes and reverberates every time he picks it up. It's also a very rocky neighborhood. We tried planting trees the other day, and you can't even dig a hole in this yard without hitting rocks. So I think it's louder than is typical, and a lot of this construction has been happening on my property line and actually over in a couple of instances. That's not 50 feet. That's at the property line. So, you know, there's no question that he's exceeding the ordinance. And that the activity is going on for hours and hours and hours on end. He's been, the last two summers, this is the third year that he's been attempting to build a pond almost on the property line, and it's failed. He's not been able to get the thing to fill up with water. It's just not working. Since Easter Sunday, he's filled in the pond, rebanked the entire brook, both sides. He's crossing the brook with the excavator, which I know is not allowed by law. But that's you know, I'm trying to stick with things that are within your purview, with this board's purview, and not waste all our time with stuff that you guys can't fix. You know, what I do know is that there's a noise ordinance that he's violating. I just, as I was reading through this, realized that he's not supposed to be pulling the dirt out that he's pulling out. And, I mean, last night alone, Jeff Miller was yesterday. The day before, it was Chelsea's Trucking. Saturday, it was his own green dump truck. I didn't see who was driving it, whether it was him or his father-in-law. But the dump trucks are going down the road to, there's a new home under construction, and then Rick Hayes is doing some work filling it across the street.
I saw a dump truck coming out of the area that's being filled the day I was out there trying to listen to.
Right. And I may have been at the grocery store when I said, no, he didn't stop all day. I did go out to the grocery store. I've been trying to keep a diary. It's very difficult to do that because if I run my vacuum cleaner, I can't hear him. If I go out to the grocery store, you know, if he was going when I left and I come back 45 minutes later and I'm still going, I can only presume either that it went for 40 minutes while I was gone or it stopped. The point is, it's on occasion gone for 12 and 14 hours in a stretch.
Okay. There are, you and I spoke a little bit over the weekend, and I invited you here because I wanted the rest of the Planning Commission to hear your observations, and I wanted the Planning Commission to know that you've reached out to Nelson Brownell, a zoning administrator, to assist you in this. It seems to me that you are admittedly in a difficult situation, because if Nelson comes and you hand him a decibel meter and the machine's not running, he's not going to observe anything. And whether or not there is a violation of bylaw section 5.1.4.2 on earth products removal is in the first instance up to Nelson Brownell to decide, not us. We are not an adjudicatory body. We pass bylaws.
Right.
And or we recommend bylaws. We don't even pass them. We recommend them to the local legislative authority. And we don't have any enforcement power.
Correct.
The zoning administrator is charged with the responsibility of administering the bylaws literally and shall have the power not to permit any land development that's not in conformity with the bylaws. So he is the person who has to determine whether it's in conformity or not. In looking at some of the materials from VLCT, the Vermont League of Cities and Towns, one of the things that they point out is that in every enforcement function, there is a degree of discretion. Think about the Obama administration's decision not to export or not to send back to their country of origin certain immigrants, and they did it because they had the discretionary authority not to do it. So there is an element of discretion in every enforcement action, and I can't tell you whether Nelson is exercising his discretion fairly and appropriately or not. But your first course of action has got to be to get Mr. Brownell's attention as the zoning administrator.
Oh.
The second thing I might suggest to you is that what you have described, quite aside from violation of zoning bylaws, if any, is a private nuisance. And in Vermont, there are laws about people causing a nuisance to their neighbor, whether it's by a dog who bites, or by loud noises, or by dust and vibration. All of those things are private nuisances. Now, that enforcement has to come privately, and that means
Correct.
Hiring a lawyer.
Yes.
And I don't say that cavalierly, because hiring a lawyer is expensive. But that is a mechanism by which
That process is currently being undertaken.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the local lawyers that we've reached out to have had conflicts, so I've had to go to Rutland.
Okay.
So I've had a little bit of trouble just getting that, because it takes a couple days when you make the call, and
oh, yeah.
then they call back, and oh, no, we can't take that case.
No, I understand.
So, if I could point out that on Saturday when I reached out to Mr. Brownell, I was told not to bother him anymore by the woman that answered the phone. I had to stop calling him. Was it Saturday or Sunday?
Yeah, it was.
I was not to call him anymore.
Yeah.
I've called him dozens of times. I've left messages. I've not had the machine picked up. I've just not bothered if the machine picks up, because he doesn't ever return a call. I've spoken to him on 6 or 7 occasions. The first time I talked to him, he said he'd go out and look around. And I said, let me know how you make out, what you hear, what you find. And he never called me back. And I let it drop until it happened again. He did arrive Saturday. I think I made a note of this, that on one occasion, and there was nobody home next door. Of mm-hmm. course. It's the only quiet day we've had
you
in
put
weeks.
Put a date in your memo.
Yeah, it's
May
in there.
7th or something.
Yeah. But he said he'd follow up, and I said, please let me know, and I haven't heard. And then when it was going on again this weekend and I tried to call, I was told not to call them again. So as far as that's concerned, I'm at a standstill.
And he came to your house Saturday, May 7th, right? It went to Jolly's. And it was Saturday, May 14th that you were told not to call again.
Yes.
Well, I... the zoning administrator is Nelson Brownell, and for better or worse, he is the person who whose attention you have to get. I think the Planning Commission will talk about it after we hear your remarks and decide whether we think there's a role for us to play. I certainly think we can pass on to him this, and I'd be happy to do that. Does anybody else have any suggestions, thoughts, comments?
One of the things I enumerated there was the, you know, while you guys are working on the new bylaws, town plan, if you would consider tightening up the regulations that just limit the kind of, this is a rural residential neighborhood, and this has been industrial activity, and it's been going on off and on for 17 years. And there's got to be a stronger mechanism within the bylaw. I mean,
we are at the stage now of revising the town plan.
The town plan, okay.
And we can't turn to proposing bylaws
okay.
for the town until we finish the town plan. We should have these kinds of considerations in mind when we're doing the town plan,
and
because our bylaws have to reflect what the town plan says.
Yeah.
And indeed, we can't do bylaws until we have a town plan. So first steps first. And your suggestion, we will certainly consider it. We will take it into consideration as we do the town plan, whether there should be some restrictions. I can suggest to you that there is in Pownal a good deal of laissez-faire among neighbors. And these bylaws, when we propose them, whatever they say, are going to have to be approved by the 5-member Board of Selectmen, who are the legislative body for the town. I'll leave it at that.
This is something that we come across a lot and we've discussed, and basically it goes under a general heading of enforcement. And we're all, you know, it's a very... laborious and confusing issue with how things not get passed, but how they are then in turn enforced or not.
Enforcement has been a big issue.
Yes.
You know, I've called the state police, and they've come out, and they brought some of it to a halt. The ATVs have stopped. We called the fire warden, and there haven't been any more fires since Easter Sunday when the fire warden came out. You're probably all aware, anyway, that we've also called the State Department of Environmental Conservation, and there's an ongoing investigation with the alterations to the stream that have gone on next door. No matter what you guys do, you can't make rules that make somebody...
be a good neighbor.
Be a good neighbor. That, you know, if they don't respect the environment or their neighbors, no matter how many rules you write, they're not going to, and I appreciate that. But I appreciate the time you've given us tonight.
Well, thank you for your comments. I will see to it that Nelson gets there.
Okay. Thank you for taking the time to speak with me on the telephone over the weekend. I don't know who all of you are. So.
Well, I'm Sid Smithers.
Julie
Weber, I think you've spoken to.
Yeah.
Bonnie Cutler.
That was Process of Elimination.
You've spoken with Jim.
Jim.
Mm-hmm. Ronnie Bassan.
Yeah, I figured that out.
Sharon Barsardi.
Shannon.
Shannon.
Shannon, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Shannon, I should know that. And Rick Morgenthau.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for coming up.
Thank you for taking the time to listen to me and read my...
If you have not your thing off the internet, but if you have a table of readings that you've observed at your property line,
I'd
be willing to
Not with me, no.
Okay.
Just my little journal, which I have to keep better. It's hard. I'm busy. I have a job. I have a family. I'm not there.
It is hard. There was an article in the Sunday Times by a woman who had just had her fourth child, had a book published, and was making book tours around the country, and she kept a log of every hour of every day, and she found out that even though she works 60 hours a week, she has 147 hours a year of excess time.
Wow. Waste her heart. And she probably spent 148 of it logging what she was doing.
No, she said 9 minutes a day.
Mm-hmm. 9 minutes a day.
This is tough. Cost me a lot more than 9 minutes a day. I want you to know.
Yeah. Yeah. You don't have to pick your chair up. You can leave it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Madam Clerk, can we turn the attention of the meeting to the mail?
Sure. We got from VLCT Spring Planning and Zoning Forum, Wednesday, June 15th at Lake Maury Resort. Lo and behold, guess what is one of their classes? Elements of effective zoning enforcement.
I actually thought about going to this.
I don't know where it is, so I can't venture out.
But it's... I saw this online and thought about going up for it.
Lo and behold.
Vermont Leagues of City and Town? Is that
yes.
Okay.
And they always have them at Lake Maury, which mm-hmm. is fine, except it's up by Dartmouth, for goodness sake.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can't travel that far.
We're not in Vermont.
No. What's that word, lazy fare, mean?
Lazy
I
fare.
I know, I was going to ask the same thing.
It's French for hands off.
Yeah, laid back.
Hands off.
Right. Kind of, anything goes.
Yeah, anything, do goes. Nothing.
Well, I don't believe it means anything goes. Maybe hands off.
Yeah.
Interpretation.
I didn't write it down because I'm like...
L-A-I-S-S-E-Z-F-A-I-R-E.
I didn't really hear.
Okay, next.
We have Strong Communities Quarterly Report for Spring 2016 edition. I think I emailed that, but I'm not quite positive. State of Vermont Department of Environmental Conservation, Drinking Water, Groundwater Protection, Glenn Metunas from the Dairy Bar on Center Street. And I have
is that a public water?
No, it's a well.
No, it's a well.
He's going to put a well in there.
No, there's a well.
Yes.
It was tested.
It has been tested.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
God bless you.
I talked her out of it.
I have the link to May 2016 VLCT News. And the reminder that BCRC's dinner is tomorrow. And I have the report. The May report. And then... Let me see. I'm going to do this one after. That's a big one. And then I have a letter from Pat Gray, and everybody has a copy of it. It's a complaint that he has. I'm not saying nothing.
What is he trying to say in that?
Essentially that his use of whether it's a particular location for site of a mobile home, he says is grandfathered.
He said it was previously
used as the location for a mobile home. And the question, and I don't think there's any doubt there was a mobile home there. The question is whether it was used for a residence.
Right.
That's the problem.
Right.
It was never used for a residence. It was a sales lot.
It was a display.
And now he's trying to make it a residence.
And grandfathered that it was... always there as a result.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
But had a different use.
That's the claim.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he did come to the DRB.
Right.
And we denied it. Thus, that's why the mobile home is still sitting across from the Dollar General.
What is that great big fat thing you had there?
Oh, this would be the south of, it's the Forest Service. It's the south of Route 9 integrated.
Integrated resource project.
Yes, and lo and behold, we have comment period. I just received it, but we need to comment by May 25th.
So each of you take this home and read it tonight, please, and so, give us your comments tomorrow.
Up here, or at some point, I guess the joint the selectmen and the PC.
I'm take the lazy fair attitude there.
A little hands off on that word, one.
Touché. What are you thinking? You might not hear the last of that.
I think I'm going to be sorry I used that phrase.
Because I guess they have, there's a trail up there for ATVs or something.
Where to begin?
I don't know. I know it was just forwarded to us. Linda said that they...
This is actually kind of interesting.
So... I mean, here's a letter that they wrote. I mean, it's shorter.
Okay, here's the letter inviting comment and telling you how to submit your comment if you wish to. I don't think, frankly, the truth is that we're not, even if we're interested, we don't have time to read this thing and comment appropriately.
What is this thing we're talking about?
Well, it's a resource protection program for the area of the Green Mountain National Forest south of Route 9 in southwestern Vermont.
Right.
And they propose a number of activities, including tree cutting, clear cutting, maintenance of roads and things like that, all described in this great big fat document.
They've been on this for like a year and a half or 2 years now, this group, right?
Yeah. And now they're inviting public comment, and they're going to then, depending upon what the comment is, they may adjust what they're going to do.
Sure.
Or they may say what they say fair and just go on and do what they want to do.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What's what they're going to do.
Anything else?
Yes, and then I just opened this, which is from Fossey, Goss, and McPhee, PC, attorneys at law. We are the Dean Road Solar. It's a petition for a certificate of public good. It's a response to the Department of Public Service comments on their rating of inverters. I think that's what that says. I might have said it wrong.
What's the rest of it?
I don't know. I don't understand lawyer stuff. Only unless I'm told it's half the bill.
Well, it doesn't. This must be written on behalf of the applicant, although it doesn't say so.
Just got it.
But when they tell you that the applicant is disinclined to do what the Public Service Board has asked, it means...
Yeah, see you later.
It has to do with derated inverters and the suggestion made by the Public Service Board, and this is the response by the applicant's, although not so identified, attorney. And since we've already given our comment on this project, I think we can file it.
Okay.
Is that okay?
That's for me.
Anything else?
Not for me.
Okay. Next item of business is public comment. I think we've had that for the evening. I don't see anybody else. Julie has in front of her the ZA's monthly log. Nelson is at a function of some kind tonight. And said he couldn't be here. sent an email to Mike Slattery saying he couldn't be here. Mike sent it to me. So, you want to read the monthly log?
Sure. This is for March and April for 2016. Number of applications received, 10. Number accepted, 10. Returned, and none. Number of permits granted, there's one verification. 7 permits on houses and sheds, 2 for additions and decks. Forwarded to the DRB, 2 subdivisions. And then his status is reviewed town for junk for shed for 5 of them. And then he did had subdivisions and fractures on trailer, if that makes sense to me. And then he had phone calls of what is allowed on people's property for Mark Gray, which is the son of Charles Gray. He wants to try to sell his little moccasin shop over there. And he got the track on water, etc., for possible uses. Water meeting, your PFOAs. Use for North Pownal Church, that's for sale. And fences, and then in parentheses says ball field and others. That's it.
I don't think it's appropriate to discuss it at length until Nelson is here and maybe Mike is here, but it seems to me that some of the ZA report, ZA log, is sufficiently obtuse and abbreviated so that it's less useful than it might be if it contained a little more detail. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we should talk about it tonight, so I'm not opening it for discussion.
Oh,
unless you were.
Being obtuse. How can you read that?
Because I have 12 years of reading Nelson's work.
Because I try to read them at the select board, and I can't read them.
It said it was written in sand.
It's 12
years. You pick it up and it moves around.
Yeah.
It is kind of a shorthand.
Yes.
This guy.
Okay, well, we will invite Nelson to attend our next meeting and discuss this with him. Turning to town plan work, we left off at the last special work session with a couple of items. Shannon was slow to get out of the room and got some transportation passed on to her.
I did, but I read it over. I didn't get a version that I can edit online.
You need a...
I need a
Word version.
Yes. And I sent an email out to Mike and to you, Julie. So maybe before our next meeting, I can get a Word version that I can... So I can add...
Julie does have one, and I actually have one in my office. So, while... And I can send it to you. I can't edit it, but I can send it to you.
Yeah. The only thing that... I mean, I had a few more questions. I didn't get a chance to talk to Mike either, so just any kind of history on it.
What do you remember what section transportation is?
10.
Okay.
Page 38 on the town plan. The only thing that really stood out to me... I mean, I have a number of questions about just... I don't know how old this version is, if things have been, you know, there's mention of road improvements. I don't know if those have happened or not. And if they have, I guess they don't need to be in the current town plan. But there was one sentence that struck me as being, I think it could be removed. It just sounds a little bit dramatic to me. Under the scenic roads designation, I don't know if people have this one. Do you have the town plan in front of you?
Well, I actually did.
It is section 10.
Section 10.
Mm-hmm.
And this, the piece that I have, I just printed out the PDF that I have.
Mm-hmm.
Starts on page 38, and I'm looking at page 40.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, you know, just looking at the language of it, I agree, you know, the scenic road designation, that's, I don't know if where any of this stands, if we've ever applied for scenic roads, and what that entails to apply. But the second paragraph starts with, but as its population grows, the town's highway network will need improvements to keep pace. This is a sense that strikes me as a little bit too much. The second one, it says, for the sake of safety and speed, majestic trees lining the roads will be cut. Stones from historic walls will be scattered, and once pleasant views will be lost. And I thought, well...
Very dramatic.
It is very dramatic. I don't think we... I mean, I think I see the point is we need to preserve our scenic roads, and we need to identify them, but...
And we should do something to prevent that from happening, perhaps.
Right. But the way that it's written, in the sense that it just says... I don't know.
It's very threatening.
Does anybody...
I wasn't sure if it is the right language.
Do you know, Ron, if there is a Vermont state statute dealing with scenic roads?
No, I know that they designated part of 346, the lower part of Route 7.
Mm-hmm.
That's all on that scenic byway thing.
And who mm-hmm. designates that? The state?
The state did that. We wanted to get... Burlington Road stuck on there.
Right.
And they were supposed to think about it. I don't know if that ever came to any more fruition, but that was rather than they did want 346, and they wanted part of 7 down here, the low part. But we wanted them to consider that.
Mm-hmm.
That was back a while ago. That was Kofi was in here then.
But that's a mm-hmm. state action, not a town action.
Mm-hmm.
No,
Massachusetts, towns can designate scenic roads within their limits,
mm-hmm.
and you can't get a curb cut off it without permission. You can't take a stone wall down. You can't cut trees.
Even on a state highway within that town?
No, town roads, town and county roads.
Town and county roads.
But not state highways.
So like a Route 7 would not be applicable?
You could not designate that as...
No.
The town couldn't designate it as scenic.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But if we don't have that law here, we should know.
We went through something like that a few weeks ago. In fact, I brought it up, and we tried to amend something, didn't we, about from Barbara Pond down to Ladd or something?
Yeah.
Something
new.
To that
mm-hmm.
effect?
Yeah.
Right. Or further south than Ladd, that there should be no further development. And I don't know what teeth that has, and, you know.
But we adopted it to put it in the plan.
Mm-hmm. We adopted mm-hmm. it to put it in the plan.
So, I mean, I don't know if this is something that could be done, but what about putting in the town plan a map of some of the scenic roads that we would be interested in designating?
I mean, I think that's a good idea.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Picture is always good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think the programmed improvement section, I think, is ancient history.
Okay, that's what I was wondering about. Some of the stuff I haven't heard about. Or
look at that. And that
before
and
my
tell
time.
Me if that's ancient history.
But just back to that scenic road designation piece.
Mm-hmm.
What I would do is just start the paragraph with, in order to preserve the visual quality of the scenic town roads, blah, 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 the town should identify its scenic roads. And I think that's really all you need to say. And then maybe include a map or
well, it's never good to start a sentence or a paragraph with the word but.
Yes, sure. So are all of those under program improvements of...
I'm asking Ronnie
cut?
To check
okay.
now. It seems to me that...
I think that, excuse me...
Well, the bridge repairs were done anyway. We got a new bridge down there.
Mm-hmm. The animal control section, there still is no holding there, from what I understand. We do have the animal control officer, but I think the processing and holding areas are still never been... I guess it was money at one point. I don't know where that money is at this point. And it never got done.
Is that under transportation?
Completed. Yeah.
Wait,
that shouldn't be under...
Program improvements is just before policies.
up there, maybe?
Oh, I'm just not seeing that part of it.
That's a temporary bridge. Just policies here.
Oh, yeah, on page 43.
Page 43.
I don't understand what that has to do
with 41.
Yeah, isn't it 41?
My book is 43.
43.
Oh, okay.
We have two books.
I know.
Animal control.
But we, as a town, discussed that a lot of times, as far as that dog thing goes, but that had nothing to do with scenic.
Exactly.
All that was to do was we don't have the money.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, that's well because right. It goes
and
under
we are willing to put dogs
programmed
into
improvement.
You're only supposed to keep them so many days to start with, and we're willing to pay for that, no matter where we have to put them. And then, if the owners don't claim them or something else, well, then they are put to a demise. Okay. We only got to keep them for 7 days, I think, or 5 days.
What I'm saying is, first of all, I don't think it has anything to do with transportation.
No, it doesn't.
I didn't see it in there.
I don't know what
sorry,
that
it's not
was.
In. It's not in.
And them class in, four roads. I don't
it's
know
not
what
in my
there
book
for,
under
not.
Transportation.
Yeah, I'm not seeing it
I'm
at all.
Seeing
what
it
I,
at all
what I got.
Someday we're going to put a man in the moon. It's in that classification.
That's where it is.
Two books.
And the other thing, I mean, I think this is pretty straightforward. Though I'm really interested in bike paths. I'm not sure. I'm not sure some of that sort of falls under recreation. But I would
and that's
love
what I was wondering because I know Mike put out something about that, and I didn't think that was really transportation.
Right. I mean, the one thing that this says is at the time of new road construction, this is under policies.
Mm-hmm.
Pedestrian pathways and bicycle routes should be implemented where appropriate, particularly within the growth centers. But that's different than, you know, a recreational
right, and I don't know if all the new road construction has, in fact, been completed, which does right. not discount the fact that there couldn't be bike lanes.
Right.
As there is a grant that we actually received in our packet today.
Oh, that's
talking
what I was
about that.
About. Okay,
yeah.
So
the same roads, like a 346,
mm-hmm.
even though there's no shoulder, you can't take it away from everybody along the line. But at least there could be a line there that says, this is my 2 feet as
mm-hmm.
a bike, and
mm-hmm.
and you have to move over, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Still precarious, but better
right.
than nothing.
So the grant helps you pay to like,
to
get
do
that,
that
created?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, and perhaps sidewalks. I think
mm-hmm.
there's...
The grant probably would come through the transportation money mm-hmm. when you're tracking it down, rather
well,
than... Recreation.
Does it though?
You're going to use their road.
In my book.
Right, you're going to use their road. But,
right here.
2016 bicycle pedestrian grants.
Delete this.
Transportation options.
Mm-hmm. For scenic.
Yeah, that would be
my agency transportation.
The
yes.
Program improvement.
Yeah, that would be a follow-up.
Is the animal control.
All the grants I see come from those folks for that stuff.
Okay, so that's the Department of Transportation, but I wonder, even though it's the same word, if that has to do with transportation in the town plan.
Transportation into recreation, but the money
right.
would come from...
money would come from the Department of Transportation, right.
Yeah.
But I don't know if the bike lanes goes in the transportation section. I don't know because I don't know.
No.
Right.
Saying, you
know. Chasing the money.
Right. It could come in recreation.
Mm-hmm.
It could possibly come in economic because, I mean, I've got
mm-hmm.
a whole printout that establishes what... people who tour on bikes bring in terms of hard and fast dollars to a community.
Half a dozen of the economics all relate to recreation.
That's
mm-hmm.
right.
Right.
That's right.
Exactly. I'm just curious about the whole Hoosick River that's in Pownal and how that could be more utilized.
Yep.
You
and
know, as far as paths along the river, bike
right.
paths. I just took my kids down to Adams, you know, and did the bike path there.
Mm-hmm.
And that looks fantastic. I mean, it's just, it's
yeah,
really
that's
great.
That's a little railroad bed.
Yeah.
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 That's
really
supposed
really
to come up to Williamstown.
Yes.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah.
I don't
yeah.
know
mm-hmm.
where the process is now.
It's in the pipeline.
I mean, it's so great.
It's going to North Adams pretty quick. Mm-hmm. In fact, Friday night you can
yeah.
go and ride a train
we
in North Adams.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
That's
so
cool.
Yeah.
Here's a perspective from Hura on where in this area they actually want to develop trails and portages and places to put boats in and all of that. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of very close areas to Pownal.
Well, I have a friend who's developing the hotel that's right. It's an old motel called the Redwood Motel.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You know, so they're developing that. And one thing I just threw out to him, I said, well, what about a canoe kayak service that goes to Pownal and back? Mm-hmm.
They are going to have a boat launch there as part of the project.
Yeah, but I mean, it makes sense to come and then get out in Pownal.
Private money, that'll come. Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, I just think that, you know, the more people you're getting to come through Pownal, the more possibilities there are.
A lot of people come to Clayton Park and get out.
Right.
Right. Or when I've done it, I get out right there by the library. Is that, you know?
Probably the best place is at the south entrance of the racetrack.
Right.
But I think you miss the best part of the river by not going through the racetrack. That's really good. But then you get to the sawmill, and then you get to kind of a rocky area before you go to the bridge.
Uh-huh.
And then, but the best ride is through the racetrack.
Right. Is that right? And you can put it on the south end of it?
Yes. That's where we put in our raft races. We go to the south end to Clayton Park.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then come out. One bad area. It's a really, really nice ride.
Okay, Julie, are you going to send Shannon the Word version of the town plan, or am I?
I can.
Okay.
And then I'll talk to Mike and or whoever I need to talk to see about what needs to be taken out. But I think those are the only things that kind of struck me.
Without Casey as a resource about what's been done and what hasn't been done to town roads, who do we talk to now?
Well, right now all we have is an interim road boss, and that's Alan. And he doesn't like to talk too much.
Linda might be able to help us.
He'll probably tell us not to call him anymore.
He will, probably. Unless you've got a problem, I'm sure he could help you out. We'll have a road boss within a month anyway.
Linda would be able to help us because her and Casey did a lot of stuff before he went away.
A lot of them roads, I mean, like them class 4 roads, they're not open. People think they are, but they're not.
Mm-hmm.
You can walk on them if you want. Yep.
I think you can safely exclude the section called programmed improvements.
Okay.
But we did do the bridge. I don't know if that was the North Pownal Bridge. That's $4 million, so we did do that.
Mm-hmm.
But that serviced quite a few homes on the other side of the river. It would have been landlocked.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Waterlocked.
That could be from 2000 programmed improvement. Possible.
Yeah, because it says current status and for completion is 2002.
Yeah, right. So it was adopted 2002,
right.
And then again in 6.
So this is probably
kicking the can down the road.
Right.
Okay, Bonnie, you and we're working with Dave on your section, and you've got your charts and graphs.
Good. Got it all. He was amazing. They pulled it out together. It's great.
So all you have to do is sign your name.
That's super.
It's all set. If you want to do email to everybody or if you want to.
I think you certainly should email it to Julie so that she can send it to. Does this go to Natalie or not?
No.
Okay. Well,
no.
It's got to get to Julie by email.
Does anybody else want
I'd like to see it? Yep, you have my email address.
I do.
Okay.
I'll email it to everybody.
Okay.
Everybody has a copy.
Good. What exactly is it that you have?
The financials, the delinquent taxes, budget history, and grand list and tax assessment.
What's
numbers and graphs.
Up to current.
Up to 2015, yes.
Mm-hmm.
What section was that, though?
9.
Municipal finance, 9.
Okay.
No, municipal management is 9, so it was the one before that. It was 8.
Yeah, books are different.
Municipal finances, 8.
8, okay. Eight.
Is there any change suggested to the written narrative in 8? You've done the tables.
We took out, these things don't apply any longer.
Okay.
Of course, the sewer bond and all that changes. And then we took out school budget. The expenditure budgets showed school, but school actually has nothing to do with town budgets.
So you took that out?
Moved that.
Okay. And any change in the text, capital programming and goals? The goals actually look pretty vanilla. Avoid drastic fluctuations in the tax rate.
I missed that whole page. Let me look at it. I'll check tomorrow.
Okay.
I have it as page 38.
I have it as
My book doesn't even have page numbers, so.
Yeah, page 30, top of page 38.
The newer ones don't when we get it.
Okay.
Julie?
I have not heard anything back from anybody yet.
Okay, and Jim, you needed some help to write up some stuff?
Yeah, we're getting it tomorrow.
Okay. Okay. Those are the sections that we are working on. Status of hazard mitigation plan. Julie, this is on here for a reason.
Because we keep coming back to it. I don't know, because we keep tabling it. Are we, because...
Who's in charge of it?
Well, that's why Michael Batcher was working around with us. But I don't know if he...
It originally started out as Casey and Linda.
That's right.
And then when we had the meeting at the school, we had the special meeting. Mm-hmm, Mike came down, went through everything. And then it ended up being still being Linda and Casey. And then Nelson said he was going to help. But, of course, then nothing ever happened. And Casey left. And so it's... And we've just been tabling it.
And Linda doesn't want to deal with it alone.
Well, she can't do it alone.
Sure.
I guess some things have been done.
Mike Slattery joined that committee. With Nelson and we're working on it. And I know Mike Thatcher wanted to come back down and talk about it.
Okay,
but
I'm going to suggest, since we're not prepared to do anything with it tonight, that once again there'd be a motion to table it till the next meeting. Is Mike expected to be back for the next meeting, do we think? What's his recuperation time?
I don't know. I never had that kind of surgery before. I don't know.
Our next meeting is until June 7th, so I would say he's going to be back.
It's our work session.
I will ask, okay. Let me send him a note. So I didn't hear a motion to table it, but I will act as though I did. Does anybody want to make a motion to table this until the next meeting?
Sure.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Well, yes, one thing. Since it was brought up about Mike Bratcher coming, or that he said he would be helpful with it, does it make sense to possibly have him come to the next meeting?
After I talk with Mike Slattery to see if he's going to be prepared to move forward with it.
Okay.
Yes or no. And so I've got a note to send Mike an email, which I don't think I'll hear back from him for a couple of days because he's going to be laid up.
Right.
And if he says it would be useful or profitable to have Mike Batcher come,
mm-hmm.
I'll ask Julie to invite him.
Okay, great. So we kind of inherited this topic.
We did.
Yes, okay.
And a vote on tabling, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried. Last issue is discussion of village designation, which we're all going to work on together.
I don't know. I know we have to do it, but I didn't know when we want it. I don't know. We all said that we work together. We all have a copy of the thing. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I did take him for a tour of the town,
the
and
guy,
he said...
Mr. Ament, was that his
name?
Amari.
And he was said, he did say there was a few things that he would cut out that was according to the past applications that we done, and that we had too much in it, but I don't know.
Well, if we don't have somebody on the commission, on the commission who's in charge of chasing cats, herding cats on village designation, it isn't going to get anywhere. So does anybody want to step up?
I don't mind doing like the pictures and, but the application, I mean, it's, where's my application? It's in here somewhere. We have the, I mean, I don't, like I said, I mean, I don't mind going to take the pictures and stuff, and I did ride with him, and he did some, you know, like.
I've got this.
He thought we did, we all have this.
I will get in touch with him.
That we all, that he thought we should not do like Matt Molden and the Clayton Park. He thought we should cut that off and go from like the library up, not, you know. He said to shorten it more than what we have previously done. But I don't know, you know what I mean?
To shorten each area as a designation?
I mean, he said North Pownal was good because of it being.
It's pretty integral.
Country, old country store to the post office. He said that was pretty cut and easy. He said Pownal Center didn't seem to be too bad because we went from like the school to here. It was just this area. And but because of Village South, Pownal, we had gone from like the Ladbrook or at the rescue squad down to the first entrance of the racetrack. Then we went down 346 Church Street and did like the library and the churches and then Clayton to Mac Molden. He said that could definitely be shorter.
Too big, yeah. I will.
So he suggested like the library to the.
I will try to get in touch with him before.
But I mean, like I said, I have no problem going to take pictures again and updating it and doing it that way. But in just, and I know Jim Henderson helped us before with BCRC. I think Michael is learning maps too.
Okay, I will take that application and get in touch with Mr. Amore. Anything else? Thank you for your time. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Your second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Why are you not our chairman all the time?